Good morning, Lou.
Good morning.
I'm Danny Hales with the Suwanee County Historical Commission, and today we want to interview you about your exciting and varied life. And we've had preliminary meetings and some questions that we've put together to talk to you. So we'll just start off right today on September the 8th, 2014 with our interview now. So introduce yourself to the people that might be watching this later and give us your date of birth. And if you can, start telling us a little bit about some of your early memories back when you were in childhood.
Thank you. I'm Lewis Walters, formerly or usually known as Lou. And back when I was a child, my family called me Billy for some reason or other. But I haven't used that name for many years, except my family still calls me Billy. I have two sisters and a brother, half-brothers and sisters, living in South Carolina. And they talk to me on the phone occasionally. But in my early childhood, I was born in Atlanta. My father was in the Army. He had been in World War I. And he was in a fire company. And they transferred to Charleston or to Fort Moultrie, north of Charleston. And so, and my grandparents, my mother's family, were living in Charleston, so my mother was very happy about that. So we moved to Charleston, and my earliest recollection of that is living with my grandparents in their home in Hampton Park area of Charleston, just a few blocks from the Citadel College, in a very nice neighborhood. I had a young brother that was 2 years younger than myself, and we lived with my grandparents. My father was out of the Army, and trying to make a living, working at various things. I can remember not too many memories of my early childhood, other than some things that brought back memories, photographs, old photographs in an album. And my brother and I were just very small children. I was perhaps 4 years old, and he was 2 years old, 2 years younger than I, and when we were kids living in Charleston. Not too much, except that when I was older, I loved to go down to the Citadel on Fridays when they had their parade in front of the general. General Summerall was the president of the college at that time, and every Friday there would be a dress review, and residents around the area loved to go and watch it, see that whole company of cadets marching, and the band, and it would be in the late afternoon, and they would have a retreat of colors. We had all the colors down, and then we would all go home. Charleston, to me, is home. I love Charleston. I've spent a lot of time there. Earlier, during the Depression years, My mother and father were separated. My father had a job to go to in North Carolina, and my grandmother, my mother's mother, a very strong-willed person from Maine. And she said to my mother, "You're not going anywhere, you're going to stay right here." And my dad said, "Well, he's my wife. I have to go and make a living." And my grandmother, as I was told later, my grandmother says, "You go, we don't need you." So my father went. And my mother, a very young woman, she worked in a couple of places. I don't remember what she did, but she liked artwork, and she liked to entertain people. And she was doing various things along that line. And later on in life, during that early childhood, it was very nice. It was before the Depression. And let's see, in 1929, the crash, stock market fell and banks closed. And my grandparents lost their property. Well, he put it in the hands of a realtor in Charleston, and he was supposed to take care of the taxes. And he didn't do a good job. And my grandfather lost the property. I think the realtor was crooked, but I'm not going to mention any names there. But anyhow, my grandfather and my grandmother tried to support us. But we, my brother and I, both ended up in the Charleston orphanage. Downtown, right behind, it used to be where, right behind the Francis Marion Hotel. And I think in, eventually they tore that building down. It was a beautiful big building, and it was built before the Civil War. As I understood that during the Civil War, it was used as a hospital. And in fact, some of the beds they had in there were iron slats, no springs, and hair mattresses, hair, or they used Spanish moss a lot of times back in those days to fill mattresses. And so my brother and I lived there. He was younger, he was in a different section, where they had the little kids. And my recollection of living at the orphanage was not bad at all. We got three meals a day, we had clean clothes, we went to school. Before I went to the orphanage, I attended James Simmons School up in the north end of Charleston. And I don't remember too much about that, but I do remember going to the orphanage. And after I got situated and decided that that's where I was going to stay and better make the most of it, things evened out. I went to school, went to a craft school in Charleston, and in the earlier grades. In the morning, we'd all pick up our bag lunch, and we would go to school. And when we came home, we had to change school clothes to play clothes, as we called it. and we were well taken care of. Later, and after a couple of years or so, my grandparents, I say, retrieved us. And we lived with my mother. She had remarried and married a man, Charleston, had been a Charleston policeman. And he was retired on a disability. Something went on around the waterfront in Charleston. He got shot, and they figured that they would retire him. But my family moved to Somerville, South Carolina, a nice home there.
Yeah, about how old were you when you left the orphanage and the grandparents retrieved you?
Well, about 7, 8.
Okay.
7 or 8, yeah, somewhere in there. We lived in Somerville in a nice home. And my grandfather had his optical business. He was an optometrist and optician. And he had a practice in Charleston. So he'd ride the train every day from Somerville to Charleston. And return, and I went to school in Somerville, and don't remember too much, although I remember one of my teachers. The teachers had a way of impressing you, either in generosity and kindness, or the opposite. So anyway, this teacher was one that everybody loved. And later on, while living in Somerville, my mother and stepfather took me with them out to a little town of Bunhall. That was B-O-N-N-E-A-U. I guess that's a French name, the way it's spelled. Well, anyway, we moved out there, and I went to school there, and they talk about one-room schools. Well, this was a little more than one room. They had a auditorium on the first floor and a couple of classrooms. On the second floor, there were two classrooms up there, but each classroom had two grades in it. And what I remember about there was the second or the third and the fifth grades were in the same room. The third grade was on one side and the fifth grade on the other side. And while you were doing one thing and the teacher was teaching fifth grade, you'd be doing homework or studying on the other side. Recess time was good. And I lived about 2 miles from school, walked both ways. And the kids from the sixth grade on went to school in St. Stephen's, in the next town north of Bunhall.
You were talking about walking to school. So during this time, did your family have any private transportation? You had talked to us about buggy rides.
They didn't have a buggy. There was farmers that lived around there. My stepfather, I like to say he was in the distillery business.
This is a retired cop.
Yeah, he had a lot of friends in the police department, and the revenue was, and they left him alone for a while, because quite often I would see a car or a truck going down the road with a big copper kettle tied to the back of it, and somebody, two or three people sitting in the back, and the older kids that I know say, well, there goes another still. And they were in the area around the Santee Swamp in Charleston, or not Charleston, but in Berkeley County. Well, revenues was the thing to do. If you couldn't get a job, you made your own. Well.
So did your grandpa was going into town to practice optician and that sort of thing, and he was using the train?
Yes, he was riding the train.
Okay.
And it was only just a few minutes ride from Somerville to Charleston.
So they didn't own a car?
It didn't have a car.
Okay. And you told me that Charleston was very early on an electrified city. So you all
yes.
had electric lights?
Yes.
But it was basically one bulb hanging from the
ceiling?
Well,
some were a little more than that. And the house, that I remember, had nice lighting. Wasn't at all fancy, but good, similar, not fluorescent lights, but regular incandescent lights. And with a globe over them. And they'd have some outlets on the wall. The wiring, as I remember, was a lot of it was knob and tube wiring.
Mm-hmm.
They had two separate wires and insulators to keep them separated. And they had fuses in the fuse box, and that was a frequent thing, they're changing fuses.
It blew all the time.
All the time. You blow the fuse, you go down. And if you didn't have a fuse, you put a penny in behind it, and that was dangerous. And there were a lot of fires blamed on that.
And did you have an ice box or a refrigerator?
We had an ice box. And the ice man would come, and he put in a 10-cent block of ice, which was pretty good. That would last you. Oh, a day, two, maybe 2 days, depending on how often you open the ice box. And we used a lot of ice for drinks. And then later on in life, when I was older, I moved away from Somerville, and from Berkeley County, and. I went back to Charleston, went to school, went to, craft school was up on the lower end of the city, and I lived on Buffane Street down near Colonial Lake. Colonial Lake was a lake that, I guess, had been a marshy area, and they built a park around it, and a gate, so that when the river was high, the water would come into the lake, and then they would close the gate to keep the water up, and then occasionally they let it down, and replenish the supply when the river was high again. There was a couple of people had rowboats on the lake. There were nice homes around that area. And as a child, I spent a lot of time down there around the river. I loved the river. And I liked fishing and crabbing.
Would that be blue crab?
Oh, yeah, blue crabs. You go to the market and get the butcher to give you an old chicken neck or something, and you tie a iron bolt or something on a piece of line and a chicken neck to it, and just put that over into the water where you thought there were crabs, and you could tell when they were pulling on it. And we'd coax them to the top and then try and catch them with a dip net or whatever you could get underneath before they let go. And crabbing was a lot of fun. Oh, sometimes I'd take home a bucket full of crabs, which was good. I was living with my grandparents, my grandmother then. And she was doing domestic work to make a living, and with a family in Charleston, North Charleston. I think, can I mention names?
Sure.
The Kerr family, Mr. Basil Kerr, owned a movie theater in the upper part of Charleston, on King Street. And there's his father, I think it was his father, had a shoe store, and he lived with the family. And then I think it was the Kerrs had two boys, two or three boys and a couple of girls.
So this was your grandmother that was sort of a nanny to them, helped
yes,
raise them?
Yes, that's right.
Was your mother living with your grandparents?
No,
too?
My mother had gone off and lived with my stepfather.
Okay.
I remember she lived in a house down on St. Philip Street in Charleston. Mrs. Hample was her house. It was an old house built back before the Revolutionary War, I'm quite sure, because it had slave quarters in the backyard. And the front door opened out onto the sidewalk, and you opened there and you went into a long porch. And then and into the house. And one of the things I remember, Mrs. Hample had, there were several ship captains. When they came to Charleston, they'd move off the ship.
They need lodgings.
And they'd stay at Mrs. Hample's. And they got room and board there. And one of the guys brought her an animal from Africa. It was a type of a cat, but it had been sort of domesticated, and it looked more like a lynx. It had a bob tail, and that cat, the cat's name was Bum. And the cat would sit up on the wall, and had a high wall along the sidewalk, oh, about shoulder height. And the cat would sit up there, and if any dog came down the street on that side, the cat was there ready. And as the dog got underneath, the cat would jump on the dog's back and dig in and ride it down to the next corner, the dog yelping, and the cat would get off there and come back home. Well, it got to be to the point where any dogs that had ever been down that street went on the other side of the street, and always looking over to see where the cat was. But that was one of the a fond memory. You know, there are memories like that, things that you don't forget. They tickle you a little bit.
Yeah, they do.
Yeah, when you recollect them.
Well, go back to the craft school, and now you're probably, what, 12 or 13 or so?
About 12 years old.
Okay.
And I was in the 7th grade. And I got a chance My grandfather had moved. He had gone to New York and with another optometrist in New York City. And Caswell and Cole were the names of the optical business. And so then eventually there was an optometrist in Haverhill, Massachusetts. And that's Haverhill. Some people call it Haverhill, but people that lived up there just said Haverhill. Well, he got into the business there. He bought the business from a woman, a widow of the previous optometrist. And so my grandfather bought that and was doing fairly well. So my grandmother my grandfather wanted her to come back. And they had agreed that when it was right time, he would send for her. Well, I had, while I was in Charleston, I met a man from Connecticut who was principal of a school there, and he was down at the College of Charleston taking some summer courses, he and two teachers. Well, he had a nice car, a Packard touring car. And he drove down in that, and the two teachers came with him. Well, I would see him down around Colonial Lake and struck up an acquaintance with him. And I told him that I wanted to go to Massachusetts, but I needed a ride. Well, he was kind-hearted. He said, well, if your grandmother will agree to it, I'll give you a ride to Boston. And you can get on the Massachusetts Street Railway that'll take you up to Haverhill. And Massachusetts had that railway system, or bus system, the subways, the surface cars, and the buses. You could ride all day for a dollar. Well, anyhow, he took me up to Boston and took me to the station and told me where to go to get my ticket. So it was a two-day trip over the road, and we spent one night in a motel. He was a very kind man. He took care of all the expenses.
So he got you up. Got me up to be with your grandparents.
With my grandfather. And then my grandfather had an apartment at a nice apartment house in Bradford, which was a suburb of Haverhill, and over near the Bradford Junior College. A month or so later, my grandmother and my younger brother arrived. They came by bus. And that way we established a family again. And I went to high school. My first year of high school was in Haverhill. I walked, it was about a mile from where I lived to school. And winter and summer, the trolleys were running there. And in the winter time, the trolleys, because of the ice on the roads and so forth, and sometimes the trolleys didn't run. But I didn't ride them, I walked. I couldn't afford to ride the trolleys. So I walked to school every day. And in the summertime, I try and get a job in a grocery store or someplace, part-time. Mm-hmm. And then 1 year in high school, 2 years in high school, in my second and third year of high school, one of the teachers gave me a job. He and another man operated a boys' camp on an island in the middle of a lake in New Hampshire. And he asked me if I was looking for a job for the summer, and I said yes. He said, well, I need somebody for assistant chef. That was what he called it. It was just a pot walloper, a dishwasher.
Yeah.
And so that first year, I worked out there during the summer, and it was enjoyable. I had a lot of fun. And the second year, I was offered the job again. And this time, about the first week or so after the camp opened, the old chef got sick. And he just couldn't carry on. So every evening I'd go out and he'd tell me what they were going to prepare for the next day. And he said, now you're going to be the chef, but I'm going to tell you what to do. So one of the counselors took over the pot walloper job, and I was the chef. Well, I was 17 years old.
And, well, soon after that, you obviously got out of high school.
Yes.
And what I'd like to do now is to move forward to, then you went into the military.
Well, I got out of high school, and my grandfather moved his practice to Quincy, Mass. And with the Dr. Michael. So it was Michael and Cole. And we lived, had an apartment in Quincy, and eventually my grandparents moved to Braintree, Mass. And he bought a home there. And then my brother and I lived there. And after 2 years of beating around, working odd jobs here and there, I worked at Remick's store in Quincy, Mass. And Remick's was a nice men's and women's clothing store, and a shoe department and a youth department, you know, a high-class store. And then I decided, well, I'd like to join the Navy. And as a youth, was in the Sea Scouts. And I enjoyed that. And the stories I heard about the Navy and so forth got me excited. So I joined the Navy in 1938, and went to boot camp in Rhode Island, and my first ship was an old four-pipe destroyer, World War I destroyer, and 21 feet wide, and we used to say that destroyer would roll and pitch in dry dock.
Not that stable, huh?
Yeah. And the Navy decided to get rid of some of those old destroyers, and they gave Canada a bunch of them. And the one I was on was one they took to Canada. So we sailed it up there, and they had it all outfitted with, all repainted and everything. And stocked with good food. Number one, when we got in the dock there at the Navy Yard, they've taken all that stuff off. And I said to one of the Canadian sailors, I said, what are they doing? Oh, he says, mate, that's for the officers. We don't get that kind of grub. So, and they took all the bunks out and put in hammockers. And they didn't, we slept in bunks. They were sometimes folded up against the bulkhead. And then you put them down at nighttime. Well, they put hammocks in, and they slept in hammocks. And then I got transferred after I came back to the Navy Yard in Charlestown, north of Boston there. I went on a Navy oil tanker and had been the S.O. Richmond, brand new ship, twin screw, 586 feet long, and it was an ocean-going oil tanker. And they outfitted it for fueling at sea and sent us to the West Coast. And we were to organize it in such a way that we could, fueling at sea operations were routine. And so we had all kinds of experiences with that, fueling ships while we were underway. And then I went on the Nevada at Pearl Harbor. And
that was in what year?
That was in 1941. And I was on the Nevada a couple of months when Pearl Harbor happened. And
what was the feeling before Pearl Harbor? Did y'all have a sense that this world was going to go to war?
Well, there was the guys were talking, hey, we're going to get into something. But we talked more about Germany than Japan. Mm-hmm. Japan, and at the time, the ambassador to Japan was in Washington negotiating with the president and with the Navy Department. And I don't think he knew what was going on. But that Navy Admiral in Japan was running things. He was running everything, and the Emperor was not, he wasn't aware of it. I don't think he was. From what we found out later on, that he wasn't fully aware of what was going on.
But, well, I was just interested in, I got you a little off track, so yeah. Go back to the Nevada. Now you're on the Nevada, and you're in Pearl Harbor.
And we were Pearl Harbor, and it was a good routine. We would go out to sea for a few days for gunnery practice or something of that sort, and come back in to the mooring. And this was on Sunday morning. We got up usual time, had our breakfast, and getting things cleaned up and getting ready for church services. We had church services aboard ship, Sundays. We had a couple of chaplains on the ships. We had a Catholic chaplain and then a Protestant chaplain. Well, the Protestant chaplain was a four-striper. He was an Episcopalian originally. And so that was the two of the chaplains. Later on, they got another one. They got a rabbi or a Jewish chaplain aboard ship. We had three chaplains on that ship at one time. Three or four, I've forgotten which. And but anyhow, that Sunday morning, we're getting set up for church service when all hell broke loose, so to speak. And as I remember, the gun boss, who was a Navy commander, the gunnery officer, we called him the gun boss, he was ashore, and he had the keys to the armory, and with no ammunition at any of our guns, all of our guns were silent, and regular holiday routine, and the gangway watch was the only one that had a sidearm, and he had a 45. Well, he went down and shot the lock off the door to the armory so they could get in. And some of the officers, well, the executive officer, the captain was ashore, the exec was ashore. We had the next in command was a Navy commander, I think Commander Thomas, and he was the SOP. And so when all this started, the exec got a taxi or something down to the dock. And he got a motor launch that was going back and forth from the dock to the ship. And he got back to the ship, and about that time a bomb landed and blew him overboard. Well, he didn't get hurt. He swam back and came back on board ship. And the next bomb, he got blown over again. He was an unlucky guy. He didn't come back that time. And so finally we got some ammunition at the guns. Well, the guns we had were 5-inch 25s. They were surface weapons, not anti-aircraft. Right. The only anti-aircraft weapons we had were 50 caliber machine guns. And they were not too effective with some of the Japanese ship. Although, as I remember, one Japanese bomber flying low over the water looked like he was headed for one of the hospital ships that was up at the head of the Navy Yard, and they said one of our 5-inch guns hit that plane, and a terrible explosion, because they had a TNT warhead on that, underneath the plane, and they were going to drop it. Well, they did. One of those planes dropped one, and I think it, with all the explosions and so forth in the harbor, one torpedo was headed for the hospital ship, and it got deflected and went up on the beach and never hit the hospital ship. That was divine intervention, I called it. And we had all kinds of fires going. We had fires going up forward, and just not too far from the 14-inch powder magazine. So we had two chief petty officers that took over until the senior officers got aboard. There was a chief petty officer, chief quartermaster, on the bridge, and he took control there. And we had a chief machinist mate, or a chief electrician, I forgot what he was in the engineer's force, took charge in the engineering department. Well, they got the ship underway. We were taking on water up forward, and they did that to flood the powder magazines to prevent an explosion. And the tower told the ship not to go out, and because we were heavy at the bow, so Japanese submarines were waiting for us outside. But we ran aground on the point of a land where the air base was, and we had machine guns, 50 caliber machine guns, all over the place. There was shooting at seagulls. Anything that was flying, they'd shoot at it. Well, and nighttime came, and the Japs had left, and we were fighting fires. I don't think we got any sleep at all that night. And the sections of the ship were flooded, and we had a number of casualties aboard ship. And the California was astern of us, and they sunk. They settled on the bottom. And the Arizona capsized. And there was so much going on that it's hard to remember. It was so confusing. And a lot of stuff I don't remember. And I just soon forget it, you know, because it wasn't very pleasant. But eventually, I asked for a transfer, because I was it's still ship's company on the Nevada, and they wanted to get us off of there because they wanted to use us somewhere else. Well, the Kaskaskia was back in Pearl Harbor because they were bringing fuel. And I asked, and I saw it, and I asked for transfer, and they said, let's see if we can arrange it. And the captain on the Kaskaskia remembered me, because my duty station on there was helmsman. And so he says, yes, we need another helmsman. So I got transferred back to the Cass, and we operated between Pearl Harbor and San Pedro, California, or Richmond, where the oil docks were, and operating with the fleet and various task forces in the South Pacific. And we would fuel ships at sea, aircraft carriers, whatever needed fuel. And at nighttime, we would go and pull into some of those little islands down in there, around the Fiji Islands, or Samoa, or Tonga, under those places. Some of those little islands we went to, we dropped the hook. But they logged underway because the screws were just turning slowly. So if they did that, They didn't have to warm up the turbines or anything. They had them.
You were ready to go.
We were getting ready to. If we had to, we could slip the anchor and get out. But the only guns we had were some 50 caliber machine guns up on top of the bridge on the pilot house, and some on the after superstructure. And so we operated in the South Pacific there for, oh, there was one stretch, 10 months. I logged 10 months underway. And while they did that, like in Tonga, we'd get ashore for some of us for a few hours, and already we couldn't go very far away. The island was small anyway. And then we'd go into Suva, Fiji, and a little more protection there. That was a British control.
Where did your tanker refill after you went out and serviced aircraft carriers and destroyers and all of that? You had to go back and get more fuel.
No, civilian tankers brought their cargo out to us and transferred all their cargo to us, and they went back to the States and we stayed out with the fleet.
Okay, so you didn't have to dock to refuel?
No, no. Well, we could anchor in a harbor somewhere.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
And that tanker would come alongside and we'd hook up fuel lines and transfer lines, and they would pump all of their cargo to us. Well, we also carried 100 octane gasoline for aircraft. And we had about 1 million gallons of 100 octane gas in our forward tanks. And at one time, we were around in the Coral Sea, and a bomb landed somewhere near, didn't hit us, but somehow or other it opened up a seam between a cofferdam, which was an empty area between the two tanks, and some oil got into the gasoline. That meant they couldn't use it. So we did go back to Richmond, California. We pumped all of that back ashore. They went it and refined it or cleaned it up, and then repaired the tank that had the leak, and then sent us back out again. And we were coming back to the States for something, I've forgotten what. Oh, we'd been up in the Aleutian Islands, up in Dutch Harbor, and we were stationed ship there. We were anchored there, up at the forward end of the harbor, and smaller ships would come in and we'd fuel them, because sometimes it'd be too rough to fuel at sea. And when we left there, we went back to the States. Well, in the meanwhile...
Is this the latter stages of the war now?
Well, this was before the invasion of Attu and Kiska. And we were going back, and while we were in the South Pacific, a lot of us guys, we were out on deck a lot, and that sun down there was burning, sunburned face, you try to shave. And so the doctor says, don't shave. You're going to protect your skin if you let your beard grow. So we could get away with that. But then when we went into Pearl and we were headed, we thought we were coming back to the States. We went back up to Dutch Harbor. So we were up there for a little while. And station ship again. Then we came back to the States. And I asked the captain, I had heard that the Nevada was spiking up and repaired, been repaired and modernized. They put some new guns on, some 5-inch 38 twin mounts and a lot of heavier machine guns, 40s and 20s. And I asked for a transfer and the captain. I told him why. He said, well, I'll see what I can do. And so he arranged it. And when we got into San Pedro, I got transferred to Terminal Island for further transfer to the Nevada. And I went back aboard ship. And I met some of my old shipmates. And I thought we were going to go somewhere else. I didn't imagine we'd be going back up to the Aleutian Islands. And so we went back up there for the invasion of Attu and Kiska. And we went around on Attu. And that's where they had an invasion there on the side of the island where we were. And we fired a lot of 14-inch shells, 5-inch shells onto the bay, onto the side of the island where they had a lot of gun emplacements. Because the other side of the island is where they had their sub base and their destroyer base and so forth. Well, several of our battleships and cruisers went around that side island. And they had them bottled up and they just pounded the hell out of them. And we bombarded with our 14-inch guns.
On the other side of the island.
On the island where all these other gun emplacements were, on the side of the mountain. And we drove them out of the Aleutians. And then we came back. And went into around Long Beach, and then from there we came through the canal back to the Atlantic. And for quite a while, well, we went into Norfolk and Boston, different places on the East Coast, and then we did convoy command. Admiral Bryant was convoy commander, North Atlantic, and so he lived aboard ship. He was a little short Texan, and you'd see him come out on the deck in the morning, no hat on, a leather jacket, cowboy boots. He wore black cowboy boots and a leather jacket, and he had a bugler that followed him. So he's supposed to, and the admiral's on deck, you know, he some kind of toot on the bugle, but the admiral didn't like that, and the bugler that he had following him was about the same height as the admiral. He was short. And a lot of our officers were big guys, tall. But the admiral would come around and he'd see somebody, he'd stop and talk with him and want to know what's going on. What are you doing?
Oh, go ahead, that's okay.
And but he was quite a guy.
But in the morning, the Admiral would get on the radio. He'd say, "This is Mother Hen calling all the chickens." And that was a system, a code that he used, so the various ships would check in, see if we'd lost any during the night.
In the night.
But we had a couple of baby flat tops operating with us, and the cruiser and a bunch of destroyers. And I don't doubt but what there were some submarines operating with us too. But we did that for a few times until we went into Belfast, Ireland, Bangor Bay. And we were there a couple of times. And then finally, the last time we went in there was just prior to the invasion of Normandy. And finally they said, "Nobody leave the ship. No ships come alongside. There wouldn't have no supplies, nothing." And they had a couple of battleships in the harbor there with us. And Eisenhower was the convoy, he was the land. I forgot what his general anyway, he was in charge of the invasion. And he came aboard ship, and they had people from the other ships come aboard the Nevada. And he told us what was going to happen and what the plans were.
Eisenhower himself.
And I was back on the quarterdeck, and he stood on top of one of the big ventilators where he could see him. Everybody could see him and hear him. And then when he left, and the next morning, or the next day we were supposed to leave, but it was stormy weather. Mm-hmm. And that was supposed to have been on the 4th or 5th of June. But we went on the 6th. The weather had cleared up enough. And so we went and sailed around the southern end of England, up into the channel. And we went to Normandy. There was a battleship New York which was operating with us. And they were up at one section, we were at another section. And then Nevada opened fire at an area where they had built a seawall across some sort of a marshy area. And they had anti-aircraft guns on that seawall. Well, our job was to blow a hole in that seawall so our landing craft could get through. Well, we did it. And we stayed there, and the aircraft, we had spotter aircraft, who were spotting targets for us. And one time, let's see, the New York was having trouble. They were in an area where they had an artillery gun on rails, and they'd bring it up and fire, and then they'd go back down again. And the New York couldn't get a fix on it. So this aircraft gave us the signal. We changed places with the New York, and we went up there, and when that train and that gun got to the top of the hill, it met one of our 14-inch shells.
And timing was perfect.
And timing was perfect. It spotted it just right. And Nevada had the best gunnery record in the fleet. And then we went back outside of Cherbourg, and at outside of Cherbourg at the end of the city. That was like a peninsula. And they had some coast artillery guns there that were in caves. And so they wanted us to knock them out. But we went into the harbor. There were several ships there that had already been sunk. And we did a job on those guns out there. And then there was also some snipers up in the belfry of one of the churches in the harbor. And they were sniping. So they asked the Nevada if we could help out. Well, they got a fix on that steeple, and they knocked the steeple off the top of the church with hardly any damage to the church. And there were snipers with them. And after that, they sent us down in the Mediterranean. And we went over into North Africa. And into Algiers. Or and we got ashore, went into Navy Yard there. The Free French had captured the Richelieu, which was a French battleship. And the Massachusetts, battleship Massachusetts, sent a shell through that. They gave them an ultimatum to surrender, and they refused. So the Massachusetts fired one shell, and it went right through the ship, and they struck their colors in. And they brought that, put a prize crew on it, they brought that back to Boston and took it into Boston Navy Yard. Later on, when we got back in there, I got a chance to see it. But we were operating with a task force in southern France. And I remember early in the morning when we were firing 14-inch shells, there was outside of Toulon, I think it was, there was an island out there, and they had a coast artillery gun in there. And there's a pretty heavy one. And the bombs couldn't touch it because it had heavy protection over it. So they had us, they gave us all the information necessary, and we fired one turret. And the shells went right into the mouth of that cave where that gun was. Mm-hmm. And that was all she wrote. That was the end of that. And just prior to that time, I remember we had a little lull, and we said that some of us could go topside and get some fresh air. Well, I was laying back on the after deck of my life preserver and my helmet, and laying there getting some sun, and I heard this whoomp, and I looked, and then a shell had landed about 1,000 yards from our stern of the ship. And before they could even sound general quarters again, I was up on my feet and down on my battle station. And that was when right after that, they fired at that coast artillery gun and took care of that. Well, when that was over, we left, and came back to Norfolk, Virginia, and for some repairs.
How late was this in the war now?
Getting towards the end of the war.
Okay.
And I got, well, it was about, well, about a year before the end. And I got transferred, a bunch of us got transferred to Philadelphia and for new construction. And so I got, went to Philadelphia Navy Yard and transferred to the cruiser Los Angeles, which was still under construction. The Los Angeles and the Chicago were sister ships. And Chicago raised more money, so their ship went out first. Well, we stayed there, and I went to school for things to do. Took a refresher course and various things.
And bring us up then, because that was the California, and then bring us up to the end that you had shared with us about the boat, the California getting to L.A. and the mayor of L.A.
Well, now the California went out, or the Chicago went out first. Then we were under construction and nearing completion. And we're going to make the shakedown cruise. Commissioning of the ship. Well, the mayor of Los Angeles was invited to come for the commissioning and to make the shakedown cruise with us. That was Mayor Byron. And so we went out on shakedown cruise, and while we were out on that, the war ended. And in the Atlantic, Germany had surrendered. And so we were down in the Caribbean, and a bunch of us were eligible for discharge. And so they told us, if you guys want to get off at Gitmo, we'll let you off here. But you might be there 6 months before you got transportation back to the States. So the mayor had talked with the captain, and he said, the city of Los Angeles will provide first-class transportation to those men that want to go back to Boston. Because there was about 12 of us from the Boston area, and we all wanted to go home. So we agreed to stay on until they got to Los Angeles. Well, we pulled into Long Beach Harbor, and we had our orders, and when the gangplank went over the side, there was a station wagon there to pick us up, a station wagon or a bus, I forgot which, but this took us out to the where the train was. And the mayor had arranged with a Pullman car for us. We had the whole car, and we had a porter that was going to stay with us. And when they pulled us out on the end of a troop train, and we said, oh, this is a farce. But the minute when we got outside, they took our car off and hooked it onto the end of a passenger train. Took us to Chicago. The same car we stayed with went Chicago to New York to Boston. and the same porter stayed with us all the way.
First class, right?
First class. We had anything we wanted to eat. When the dining car was open, we went first. We had whatever we wanted. We could have anything we wanted to drink. And as they said, you can have anything you want, but no women. No women. This car is for sailors only. And after about, I think it was 2 days or so, we were in Boston. And transferred to the receiving station, Boston. And while we were a couple of days, the first day in the morning, they said, Nevada crew, we're not ready for you yet. If you live anywhere nearby, go home, come back tomorrow morning. So we did that. And every morning we'd have to be there at muster at 8 o'clock. And we'd hear them call off the list of sailors that were going to be discharged that day. And we went on it. So we go home again. Well, the third day, they finally called us. And I remember we had to be examined. We had to see a psychiatrist. A lieutenant was sitting there, and he was the psychiatrist. And he said to me, Walters, what are you going to do when you, where are you going to be when you get out of the Navy? I said, a civilian, what do you think? He looked at me and laughed. He said, nothing wrong with you, get out of here. And so when I left there, I had my papers with me.
Okay, well, let's stop and just take a short break.